He is risen. He is risen indeed. Thank you. It's a beautiful morning, and to help us celebrate, we're going to have the handbells helping with a couple of hymns this morning, but we also need you to help us celebrate. So we're going to sing Up From the Grave, He Arose. So I would like for you to all stand and join with us. Thank you. The date is April 17th, which is a Tuesday evening, and it begins at 6 o'clock. And Sarah Solis, who was a former member of our church, I don't know if you remember her, she sang in our choir. She is going to be our entertainment with a few of her friends, and we're looking forward to an enjoyable evening. We have a sign-up sheet for you, and as it goes down one side, please send it around to the other, and hopefully you can attend. There are a couple of inserts in the bulletin if you will take a look at those. One of those tells you who the beautiful flowers are in memory or honor of. If there are no other announcements, please rise and greet everyone this morning.
We get settled back in. There's a couple things I want to announce. One is on the insert in your bulletin, listen for your information. Some of you may find it interesting. Pastor Rick Enroll is holding electronic identity detection seminar, so you look at that information there. If there's something that you think would be important to you, please take note of that. As Leanne said, thank you all for the beautiful flowers that makes the sanctuary appear so much brighter and nicer. We enter into that time of sunshine. He is risen. He is risen indeed. We are glad that you are with us. Because I have so many of you, I just want to lift up a couple things. As we go into the Easter season, as we conclude this day with He is risen, next week we'll continue that resurrection story as we look at a couple of the I am sayings. I am the good shepherd. The week after that, we'll look at I am the true vine. And then we're going to go into a sermon series, and that's what I want to talk to you about. We're going to do a series on the prodigal son. And for those that may remember that story, the prodigal son is probably one of the most compassionate love stories in the Bible. And so I hope that you would look at that and put it on your calendar. We'll do 4 weeks. We're going to talk about the son, the younger son, leaving. And then the next week we'll talk about the younger son coming back and how he made that decision coming back. We'll talk about the older son and find out where we identify ourselves with either the younger son or the older son, or do we find ourselves, identify ourselves in the next week with the father. So I hope that you'll find those sermons interest in that you can apply in your everyday life. We're glad that we have a guest singer here, and we look forward to that a little later. Let's prepare our hearts and our minds as we go through time of worship as we listen to our prayer room.
Opening prayer. O God of our days, We come this morning with eager anticipation. We seek to know you, to see you, to touch you. Open our hearts that we might experience you anew. Open our lives that we may be faithful witnesses to your resurrection. May we, the house of joy, proclaim your steadfast, liberating love to all people and everywhere.
Thank you.
It's that time of worship service where we can go to the Lord in prayer. Some of you have made a lot of sacrifice by driving all night from your vacation times to be with us this morning. And we are really appreciative of that sacrifice that you are making. We come together here. Not only do we come to sing and to hear the music, to hear the Word of God preach, but we come for another reason, and that's what we do here. We come for each other, to hold each other up in those times of need, to celebrate with each other, with those joys. A couple of prayer concerns that were lifted up that are really joys. Gene, it's great to see you here. For those who know, Barb has been moved to a rehab facility in Valparaiso, Avalon, and is doing great. John Slinger, Reverend John, has been visiting. I visited her the other day, took communion to her on Friday. She looks wonderful, and hopefully she'll be home soon. But continued prayers that to make that happen as we celebrate that. And then Kathy, I don't know, is this a prayer concern or a joy, but Gwen's turning 14 on Thursday. So Gwen, we celebrate with you as well. Other prayer concerns and other joys if you like lift it up. Two.
Yeah.
All right.
Avery turns 3 tomorrow.
3 tomorrow. There is a men's and man's walk that's taking place this coming weekend, Thursday through Sunday. I'd ask that we keep those pilgrims, as we call them, and the team itself in your prayers as they 72 hours of simply trying to draw them closer to the knowledge and love of Jesus Christ. We're going to go up to just a moment of silent prayer, allowing you to take your own concerns up, and then after just a brief moment here, I will close with a prayer. Most merciful God, we come before you with all praise and honor, giving you thanks for your faithfulness in raising Christ Jesus from the dead. And we behold the glory of your only begotten Son, who now sits at the throne of your right hand, who intercedes for us. And so, God, we give you thanks because he lived, because he died, because he lives again. And through that living again, we have gained a vision of your eternal order. Because he stopped to minister to the least of your people, we too have hope that can lift our spirits out of despair. Since he taught us how to love our neighbors, dividing walls of hostility, may no more keep us apart. When the angels proclaimed his coming to bring peace to all the nations, we have gained a glimpse of your promise that swords shall be beaten into plowshares. We give you thanks through Jesus Christ. Your laws are written in our hearts, that no longer can we claim to hide from you. No longer can we claim that you hide from us. And so, God, as we seek to serve others, your Holy Spirit is with us. And when we face troubled times, we know that you are the source of our comfort and our strength. Our prayer this morning is that on this Easter day, fill us with hope as we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. God, we come to you as your people. You've heard those joys lifted up of birthdays that are coming, of healing that has taken place, of healing that needs to take place. And so, God, we simply pray that your Holy Spirit would surround all of these individuals gathered here, their extended families, that they would feel your presence. And in that presence, they would find comfort. God, we pray for our nation. We pray for the leaders of our country and of all countries that you would guide them in the decisions they make. We pray for our young men and women in the armed forces. We pray for their families. We pray that you would keep them from harm's way. But most of all, God, we come here this day to give you thanks. To give you thanks for the love that you have for us. That not only you would allow your only Son to die for us, but that death would not be the last. That we find hope in the resurrection. And so, God, we give you thanks for this day as we invite Jesus into our hearts to strengthen us once again. As we pray the prayer that your Son taught us with these words, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I'd invite the kids to come up. Good morning. How are we today? How are you? You look pretty. Your dress is all dressed up. We're going to talk about Easter, and I know it. Do you think I can use some aids to help us understand the Easter story? You think? Well, let's see. And hopefully I didn't mess this up. So if we take the blue aid out, what do we got? Well, a donkey, right? The donkey reminds us of how Jesus rode into Jerusalem last Sunday. We celebrated Palm Sunday. So that tells us about that. How about, what do we have in this one? Some coins. Money, right? The 30 pieces of silver. You have some money, too? You, wow. I don't have any money. I'm married. I'll pay for that later. What do we have here? A cup?
Yeah.
A cup? And this is to remind us of, well, we're going to do a little later, Holy Communion, how we drank from the cup. You too? All right. And we got some praying hands. Yeah, to teach us how to pray to Jesus. What? We slowly lose control of it. What do we got in this aid? A whip. Yeah, remember how Jesus was beaten with the whip? So that reminds us of that day.
Mommy has a jumpy rope.
She has a jump rope? All right. What's the chicken remind us of? The rooster. Huh? Then the rooster reminds us of when Peter denied him 3 times and the rooster crows, right? So we got that one. Now let's hope we go the right way in this direction, huh? What do we have here? Oh, a crown of thorns? Let's put it. Yeah. It's a fence? Well, it could be a fence, but we're going to call it a crown of thorns, okay? So that's what was put on Jesus' head, right? Well, what do we have in this one? Cross. Really, it's the nails put together. And this is the nails, what they use for nailing to the cross. And the exact. What do we have? What do you think we have missing? That's a stick. That's a spear, right? How they stuck him in the side. Yeah. You think it's a wand? How about in this one? Yeah, a white cloth. Remember that tells us how they wrap him in his body in a white cloth? All right. And then what do we have here? A lock? Yeah. Remember the rock was blown in front of the tomb? Okay, yeah, well, we'll put it right back in there, okay? And what do you think is in this one? Think there's anything in here? What happened when Jesus put in the tomb? Is anything in there? There's nothing in there, right? Because Jesus isn't dead anymore, right? He's alive, he's risen. And so that's why we come together today to celebrate. There's nothing inside because that means he's gone. He's alive and he sits with God. There's a boo-boo on my hand. Yes, there is. Yeah, mom has money. Okay, come here. I want to talk. We both have watches. That's cool, isn't it? But different colors. So today we celebrate Jesus being alive again. And so that celebration tells us he could take care of us. So remember what today is all about, what Easter is all about. Easter, but it's not just about the Easter bunny and about chocolate, it's about how Jesus loves us so much, right? You pray with me? God, we just give you thanks for these children gathered here. For the love they have for this church, the love they have for their families, the love they have for each other. Lord, we give you thanks for the love that you have for them. We just have to pray that on this Easter Sunday, you surround them with your Holy Spirit, and just as they continue to grow in stature, that they would grow closer to you. And in Jesus' name, amen. Now, before you go, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, I got something for you, but you can't do anything with until your mom says you can, okay? Because otherwise, I'll get in trouble. It's chocolate, but now it's got to be a chocolate crust, right?
So you have those in our bag.
Well, you get another one then.
Please come forward.
Offerings as a pledge to our faith.
first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one who Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white, seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. The word of God for the people of God.
He has risen. He has risen indeed. Today is Easter, but it's also April 1st. And how do we reconcile those two dates in the Christian calendar? When's the last time that it's happened? How often do you think that this happened? Since 1700, it's happened 11 times. The last time it fell on Easter was 1956. The next time it happens is 11 years from now, 2029. And then it happens another 11 years in 2040. But then it doesn't happen again for another 68 years in 2108. And then after that, it's 62 years before it happens again. But today, it's here. So we've got to have some fun with it to an extent, right? I mean, what is there about April 1st that brings out that prankster in all of us, right? I mean, you have to have those April Fool's jokes, right? And I'm sure that you have your best one that you've done or that someone has done to you. This couple, let's see. Have you heard of the caramelized onion? Take a nice lemon about the shape of an apple, peel it, put a stick in it, dip it in caramel, give it to your co-worker for a taffy apple. I mean a taffy onion now. And then watch him bite into it. Yeah. Or maybe it's, cut out an outline of a bug and attach it, affirm it to the shade, the lampshade of your significant other and watch what happens when they turn the light on. The BBC ran a documentary once where they showed the harvesting of spaghetti. Right. They called it the Swiss Swift Spaghetti Harvest. They were flooded with phone calls wanting to know where to buy the spaghetti onions. So much that they had to go on the internet and tell everybody it was a hoax. Today is April Fool's Day, but it's also Easter. It's the day we celebrate the resurrection. Why is the resurrection so important in the Christian faith? Because it identifies who we are as followers of Jesus Christ. There's no other religion in the entire world that can boast of a Savior who lived and died and lives again. The resurrection is what vindicates and defines who we are. It's what gives credence to everything Jesus said and taught. Without the resurrection, Jesus just becomes another nice guy, another prophet, someone to listen to, but not necessarily follow. It's the resurrection who defines who he is, and therefore defines who we are. It's Easter, and we celebrate. But it's also April 1st. And so who are the April Fools during this time? Who are the April Fools? Maybe Pilate. You know Pilate, who didn't have the backbone to stand up to the religious authorities? Oh, he gave some lip service here and there, but he washes his hands. He allows the crucifixion to happen. But not only allows it, he allows it to happen in the name of the emperor. And Jesus is dead. But it's Easter. And Jesus is risen. April Fool's, Pilate. Or maybe the April Fool's are the disciples. I mean, let's be clear about what they must be going through before they, again, we know the end of the story, but they didn't. You wonder how the disciples felt when Jesus was being led away to be crucified. Someone who they followed for 3 years. Someone who they had given up everything. They'd left their homes, their families, their jobs. They traveled up and down Palestine for 2 years to arrive at this point. To see Jesus be led away like a lamb to the slaughter. Their hopes and dreams dashed. They scattered. They betray. They go into hiding. The man that they had pinned their hopes and dreams on is no longer with them. They have seen him nailed to the cross. And they abandon him. But it's Easter. And Jesus is risen. April Fools to the disciples. Or maybe it's April Fools to Annas. Remember Annas the high priest at Caiaphas, his son-in-law. You Star Wars. Annas is the dark emperor. The evil. The one that it does things that only other people with evil minds would think of. Corrupts witnesses. He falsified information. He plants a mole in Jesus' inner circle. Who finally decides enough is enough and it's time to have Jesus get rid of. To have him killed. To have him crucified. He pulls the strings on Pontius Pilate like a West Virginia fiddler. He just doesn't have any respect at all because Jesus is dead. But it's Easter. And Jesus is risen. April Fools, honest. Or maybe the April Fools are the guards guarding the tomb. I mean, after all, think about it. Why do you need guards guarding a dead person? You have to ask, what did the guards do to get this kind of duty? Did they get caught drinking on duty or playing dice or some kind of dereliction duty that they got this punishment where that they have to guard the tombs of dead people? You imagine the jokes that the other soldiers are talking about them as they guard the tomb of Jesus. After all, they saw him put in there, he's dead. But it's Easter. And Jesus is risen. April Fools to the guards. Maybe the April Fool that's on Peter. Remember Peter the fisherman. Peter, who's the one who said he would never abandon. Peter, who's the one that proclaimed him the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of the living God. Peter, who is the one that draw his sword and cut off the ear of Malchus. Peter, whose faith abandons him, whose faith sinks like a rock in water, who denies him three times. In the courtyard, Jesus is crucified. But it's Easter. And Jesus is risen. April Fool's Peter. Or maybe it's Thomas. Yeah, Thomas is the smart one. Thomas is the PhD from the Institute of Jerusalem Technology. He's the one that sees everything and knows all things. He's the one, remember, when Jesus said, I go to prepare a way for you, and Thomas is the one that says, how can we know the way? Maybe it told us. Thomas is the smart one with science and everything that says, when the disciples come to tell him that they've seen the risen Lord, he says, right, until I see the nails holes in his hands. Until I can put my finger in those holes, until I can put my hands in his side, then and only then will I believe. But now it's Easter. Jesus is risen. April Fool's, Thomas. But perhaps the April Fool is all of us. I mean, much of the world would say we're the fools, wouldn't they? I mean, much of the world would look at you and say, why are you gathered here on Sunday morning? Why do you put your trust in faith? Use Jesus as a crutch? Why do you followers of Jesus take him so seriously? Maybe you're the April Fools. And perhaps they're right to a certain extent. Maybe we are the April Fools. When we claim to believe, but behave as if he doesn't. Maybe we're the April Fools when we claim to believe in the resurrection. But we live our lives as if he's still dead in the tomb. I mean, we shout that he is risen. But do we believe? And we affirm our belief with our lips, but do we confess Jesus as Lord of our lives? And do we live our lives in that way? Because it's Easter. Jesus is risen. Able fools. You know what the biggest able fool? It's not Pontius Pilate. It's not the disciples. It's not Thomas. It's not Annas and Caiaphas. It's not you and I. It's not Peter. It's none of us. The biggest April Fool is Jesus Christ. The biggest jester of all of us. The one who called the devil's bluff. I mean, think of how he acted and how he lived his life. Foolishly, we'd say. I mean, he didn't ask for comfort. His friends were, tax collectors, hookers, lepers, fishermen, poor, needy people he hung around with. And he'd tell people to give away their wealth and come and follow him. Because he understood. So. He understood there's power in being somebody, but there's truth in being nobody. He understood that truth is where power truly emerges from. Chooses weakness over strength. Honesty over influence. Vulnerability over aggressiveness. He was willing to poke the fingers in the eyes of the religious establishment, if you will, to deliberately bait those who wanted nothing more but to kill him. And they did. But it's Easter. He is risen. April Fools. You read in Corinthians, God made foolish the wisdom of the world. Jesus was God's fool. We read he was a stumbling block to the Jews and foolishness to the Greeks. We read where it was through Jesus that God reconciles himself to the world. So today we celebrate. We celebrate that he is alive. That he's taken his rightful place, right hand of God the Father Almighty, where he sits. We celebrate Jesus who took the form of a slave, who emptied himself, who was born into human likeness, but became obedient to the point of death on the cross. And we celebrate that God raised him from the dead, exalted him with a name that is above all other names. Jesus Christ. The name where we sing, every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord and Savior. On this Easter Sunday, we humble ourselves to reaffirm our allegiance to who we worship and why we worship. To Jesus who pulled off the greatest jest in the history of the world. Now there will be people who think you are crazy. There will be people who think you are wasting your time. But you and I know that's not true. You and I know we come here today to celebrate the risen Savior, conquered death, that gives us hope, that death does not have the final word, that death is just a journey. And so we gather here this day, at this time, to recommit ourselves as followers of Jesus Christ. We do that by the celebration of Holy Communion. I'm going to ask that you turn into your hymnals on page 12. And page 13 under the Greek Thanksgiving. Now I'm going to be reading from the Book of Worship, which will be slightly different. And I think you'll be able to follow with me. Under the great thanksgiving, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
And lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right, man, a good and joyful thing always and everywhere. To give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image. You breathed into us the breath of life. And when we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, brought us to a land flowing with milk and honey, and set before us the way of life. And so with the people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. By your great mercy, we have been born anew to a living hope through the resurrection of your Son from the dead, and to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, unfading. Once we were no people, but now we are your people, declaring your wonderful deeds in Christ, who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks, and he broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to your disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." On the day he raised him from the dead, he was recognized by his disciples in the breaking of the bread. And in the power of the Holy Spirit, your church has continued in the breaking of the bread and the sharing of the cup. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out the Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to the entire world until Christ comes in that final victory. We feast at his heavenly banquet. All this we ask in your holy church with your Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours now and forever. Amen. Body of Christ, broken for you. The blood of Christ, shed for you. As we come to the Lord's table, and it is the Lord's table, it's not our table, all are welcome. You do not have to be a member of this church or any other church in order to participate in this feast. This feast is for you. You simply have to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Today we'll take communion by one way. We don't take communion, we receive it, so I'll give you the bread and you'll dip in the cup. We do have gluten-free if for those who need that. If we come up and let us know, and we'll make sure that happens. And as we come through the center aisles and exit down through the outside aisles, the table is set. Come if you are ready.
rise if you are able and join us in our final hymn.
He is risen.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed. Go with the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the presence of the Holy Spirit, be with you this day and every day. Go in peace, and peace of God will go with you. Amen and amen.